worship you, we praise you, we give you glory. We thank you, God, for your power and for your presence. We thank you, God, for who you are. We thank you, God, that you are God. We thank you, God, for salvation. We thank you, God, for another day, another opportunity to live for you. What a privilege it is, God. We thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for your presence, for your power, for your glory. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father, that we can come into your presence, God. Oh, where there's fullness of joy and peace. We thank you, God. We thank you, God, that you are the Almighty God, the everlasting Father. You're the Prince of Peace. We thank you, God. You are the deliverer. You are the way maker. We thank you, God. We thank you, God. There is none other like you. There is none other equivalent. God, you have no rival. We thank you, God. We thank you, God. We just give you praise this morning, God, because you're worthy of our praise. You're worthy of our praise. You're worthy of all the praise. Thank you, Jesus.
Open up heaven. Yeah! Come and do what only you can do. Peace in his joy. We find love in his joy. We're ready. ready for you. We make our hearts ready for you. We make our minds ready for you. So ready, so ready. We make our hearts ready for you. We make our hearts ready for you. We make our hands and our feet ready for you. We're so ready.
I'm coming in. I'm coming. Kirama sandele keko You can assure yourself what you prayed in the Holy Ghost will come to pass because you're releasing your most holy faith. And then he'll give you interpretation where you can interpret what you prayed if you do that enough. Always use your prayer ring because the prayer ring with the enemy cannot set up a trap for you because he don't know what to say, and neither do you know what to say. But Holy Ghost knows exactly what to say, and then he downloads to you the purpose that you need to do it to fulfill what it is he had for you. Thank you for that, Father God. Thank you for that, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Bless your hand. Lift your hands to heaven and just thank him for it. Thank him for it. The presence of God is so heavy in this room. Anything you need is in the atmosphere. You can pour it down into the realm of your atmosphere, not in the realm of your manifestation right now, because it's here. We just need to realize that don't let the enemy trap you and try to fool you that nothing's going on. He's moving all around in this place. Thank you for your presence, Heavenly Father. Thank you for your presence, Jesus. Thank you for your presence, Holy Ghost. Move. Move in this place. Change situations, Father. Let you know that you are God all by yourself and you don't need nobody else. We just thank you now to release our faith. All we must do is receive it in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Thank you for financial breakthrough.
Thank you for whatever it is, business, Father. Release. Yes, I release. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. We trust you with all our heart. We lean not on us. Everything we do will acknowledge you to direct our path. We thank you for the joy of the Lord is our strength. We thank you we walk by faith, not by sight. We call all things to be not as though they were. So Father God, anything that didn't look right, Father God, we need to understand. And we release our faith, Father God, and just let our faith bring us what God already reigned. We already have the victory. So we refuse to allow the enemy, his posse, or anyone else to uncheck that we already know, because faith worketh by love. And we operate in love, Father God, that we already know we have the victory. So we just thank you and praise you for the victory, Father God. We just thank you for the privilege to just come and honor you, give you all the glory and honor and praise that just is you. So thank you for the privilege, Father. Thank you for the privilege. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Nothing like being.
Yes.
in His presence. Calms all my fears, removes all my doubts, takes everything, all the burdens away from me. Thankful for Your presence.
All the honor, the glory, and the praise. Thank You for the gift of this hour. Thank You for the
gift of
this hour. Thank You, Jesus. Thank You,
Jesus.
Thank You,
Jesus.
Coming in the revelation for John to receive the revelation from Christ. He says, and after these things I looked, and behold, a door standing open in heaven. And the first voice which I heard was like a trumpet speaking with me, saying, come up here, and I will show you things which must take place after this. And so there's an invitation to John to come up higher.
Yeah.
To come to a place where God wants to reveal things to him. And so I feel like in this hour, in this moment, that is the invitation that we all have, is to come up higher. Because a lot of times we struggle with things, we have questions, we have so many things that we're dealing with, and if we would take that opportunity to... But if we would take that opportunity to come up higher, that means to give the Lord some time, give him that space. You know, in the mornings, it's not just about getting up and reading the word, but it's sitting in his presence and waiting to hear what he has to say to us. That's that come up higher, meeting him in that secret place where he can show us those things, show us those strategies. He can show us even things that are within us that's hindering us from moving into that next place in him. And so we all have this invitation today, as we were talking about, I'm not settled with the outer court. I want to come in.
Yeah.
And that's where the Lord wants. He wants that hunger and desire and passion to be stirred up for us to go to the higher place, to go to the secret place, because that's something that the world, that's something that the unbeliever, they don't have, that we have. And that's an opportunity to intimately know the creator of the universe. And so everything we need is in him.
Yeah.
And so when we find that place and space and time to get in him, therein we find everything we need, whether it's joy, peace, healing, deliverance, whatever it is found in him. And it's with that invitation this morning to come up higher. Amen.
Yeah, that's good. Love that. And that's exactly what the Holy Spirit was doing this morning. You got me on it. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Yeah. That's exactly what was happening this morning. Well, I just left y'all. Did y'all see me leave y'all? I just left you.
Yeah.
But that's exactly what you need to do individually, right? I heard Pastor Chris say something this week that really, really changed my mindset about coming to church to worship. And he said, I don't go to church to worship. I bring my worship to church. I mean, that changed everything for me. It's like, if we just change that, it's like, oh, I bring my worship to here, right? If you come in with your worship already, you already worshiping, right?
Yeah, amen.
And so you walk in the door, we ain't got time, we don't have to pump nobody up or nothing like that, because we already in the presence, right? And so, and you just kind of become intentional. This is what we need to do. We need to become intentional about going in further, you know? Don't settle. That's real good, right? Just tell somebody, don't settle. And you don't have to. Ooh, that's even better, isn't it? You don't have to settle, right? That we can come into the very presence of God. I heard Nancy Dufresne, she's one of my favorites. I've been listening to her all weekend. But I heard her say something like, you know, the scripture tells us, come boldly to the throne of grace, right? Come boldly to the throne. And then she said, the throne is in the center. That means you got to go. And she said, but he told us how to get there. He said, enter the gate with thanksgiving, right? I'll enter the gate. That's just the gate. That's just the gate. I'll enter the gate with thanksgiving in my heart. Then I'm going into the courts with praise. He's telling me how to get to the throne. And so we got so used and accustomed to having church outside at the gate. Not even in the court, at the gate. We've been having church at the gate. And God wants us to come in. Oh man, I'm telling y'all, there's a sweet, sweet, I can't even explain. But do you understand when you get like right there behind the veil, it's hard to even explain to people where you just came from?
Amen.
Right? Glory. And so we got to get to the place where it doesn't matter who's around us. And it doesn't matter who's here and who's not here. We got to get to the place where we just want to go into the presence with Jesus, right? And so it's like, it doesn't even matter. It doesn't matter. You wouldn't believe how many text messages and calls. Who wasn't going to be here? I'm not going to be here today. I'm not going to be here today. I'm not going to be here today. So I have to take my mind and say, that doesn't matter. Don't focus on that. And come in and say, I'm going in today. See, I just made a decision. It didn't even matter what she was singing. I just started singing my old stuff. Glory to God. So you become intentional about, oh, no, 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 no. See, because when you come back out, this world is crazy.
Yes, it is.
Right? And this is where we live. We in it. We ain't of it, but we in it. And so when you get a chance, just go into the presence. Man, I'm telling y'all, this outside world will be a lot easier if we learn how to go inside. You can be inside and outside at the same time. You should tell somebody that. Right? You can be inside and outside at the same time. Ooh, that's good. Only in Jesus can you do that. Only in Jesus can you do that. We're going to John chapter 8. We're getting ready to have fun. Yeah, we're getting ready to have some fun here today. I might even get some of these babies. We're getting ready to have some fun. If I keep getting this many children to come, we'll start having children's church again, I'm telling y'all. But I already told y'all, they paying for the room. Y'all keep them babies home. But if we start having this many children, we'll start having children's church. We'll start bringing snacks again. We'll start doing it. Glory to God. I need everybody to do me a favor. Stand up, put your Bible stuff down. I need you to lift your hand. This is what we're getting ready to do today. We're going to thank God for the building. Ready? Let's go. Father, we thank you for the building. Glory to God. We thank you for the place that you have for household of faith. We thank you. We rejoice in faith. Glory. We bless your name, Jesus. We thank you. We believe we receive. We believe we receive. True glory. We thank you for the building. We thank you for favor with God and with men. We thank you for the building. We thank you for the finances for the building. We thank you, God, for the furniture for the building. We thank you, God, for everything. We thank you right now, God. Glory. Household of faith is not my idea, it's yours. So we thank you for the building now. We believe we receive it in Jesus' name. Somebody celebrate like we got it.
You operate with the best of your expected best.
Yeah.
You don't set up with nothing less.
We saw a building the other day, and we did a phone call on the building. They quoted a number, I almost choked. But I heard the Spirit of God just now say, don't settle. I heard it say. So Pastor Billy called the man back, said, we coming to see it.
If any time you see something that wants you to choke, don't choke, laugh at it. You know, laughing is a form of a praise too. So you laugh at the numbers or you laugh at the situation. See, they say laughter makes the heart melt.
Excuse me, Mama, so laugh.
You laugh. You know, when he said the price, I said, ha, ha, ha. He said, did you? Excuse me, I said, that was funny. But you know what? Probably. It didn't matter. Let me tell you why I laughed. Not only was I praising God, but for what we want for the building and what we're going to do.
That's right.
We done outgrew that already. So I said, you know, that's why I laughed. We outgrew it. So my point is, it's not big enough.
Glory to God.
You see, so we can't settle it. Now, we can, if God told me to go there, we'll go for a moment. But we can't settle that. It can't hold God's people, what he's going to do there. And with that, you got to understand, it don't matter what the numbers look like. I'm just trying to tell you the mighty God that we serve can't hold his, it can't hold what he wants us to do. It can't hold. But I did tell the guy we'd come take a look.
Yeah, we're going to look at it. And this is what I know. When we walk on the property, we walk inside, we'll know.
We'll know.
We'll know if that's it. We'll know if it's not. Now, glory to God. Hallelujah.
No unction. No
function. That's right. Oh, man. The word. It's time to hear the word. So let's get excited. Holy Spirit, feed us. For everything we need is in the word. It's time to build our faith. So doubt can be replaced. So let's get excited. Holy Spirit, feed us. For everything we need is in the Word. Teach the Word and love the people. Teach the Word and love the people. Teach the Word and love the people. This is the house that loved it.
Glory.
Glory to God.
We're good.
Fantastic. We're ready.
And God got that under control, because if it don't come out, it's on God. I feel that for
Oh, praise be to God. We're going to have some fun again. Somebody said last time we did this that we had Tyler Perry in the house. So we're getting ready to do another one. Y'all ready?
Yes.
We're going to do another one today. This should be a lot of fun. Let's see who we need this morning.
Any volunteers?
We need Jesus. Who wants to be Jesus? Come on.
Everybody qualified.
You want to be Jesus? Who you want to be?
I think
somebody else this time. You were Jesus last time? Okay, I'll you don't want to be Jesus?
Come on here.
Okay, so we need Jesus. And then, wait a minute, who you be? You jumping up now? Okay, you just read
it. You need
okay,
Jesus.
I need Jesus. I need some scribes. Zion, come on, you a scribe. Josh, put your phone up. Come on, you a scribe. Come on, you a scribe. I need Pharisee. Come here, Pookie, with the blue cute things right there on your head. Come here, you a Pharisee. You a Pharisee.
Yeah, you
a Pharisee. Brian, come on, you be a Pharisee.
I'm fine.
Now, I know don't nobody want to be her, but I need the woman who was caught in adultery. Come on, who wants to be the woman today?
You pretend.
Like, I don't want to be her. Jamia, are you volunteering to be the woman? come on, who's going to be the woman? Leslie? Leslie? Come on, Leslie, you ain't got no cheer in the watch. Come on, you're going to be the woman. You're going to be the woman caught.
Yeah.
Okay, so do we have Jesus?
This is just,
you Jesus?
You pretend.
Are you being Jesus?
Jesus.
Am I Jesus?
So you got it.
And then you the Bible. Woman. Okay, we good? Okay, so we're in John 8. We're starting at verse 1. But Jesus went to the Mount of Olives. Now early in the morning, He came again into the temple. You Jesus, you going to the temple, okay? And all the people came to him. We need the people. Everybody come to Jesus. Where you going, John?
Make sure that's on.
Oh, he makes sure. I want y'all to get your film debut.
Josh, make sure the camera's on.
On the people.
The people up front.
Oh, I might need somebody else, Josh, because you need to make sure that you're catching this. Okay? You said it. Okay, so now early in the morning, he, who's Jesus, came again into the temple. And all the people came to him. Hey people, y'all come to Jesus. And he sat down and taught them. You get Jesus a chair. Jesus a chair. He probably didn't sit in a chair though, right? He probably sat down and taught whatever. But he sat down and taught them. Hey, y'all, go ahead, Jesus. And he sat down and taught them. Then the scribes and Pharisees brought to him a woman. All right, where are my scribes and Pharisees? Come on, Zion,
yeah, you can be.
Y'all bring him the woman. Okay, bring to him a woman caught in adultery. And when they had set her in the midst, they said to him, what y'all say to Jesus? Come on, Zion, and
little lot.
Teacher, what the mic? Here you go.
Outside voice.
Here we go. What y'all say to Jesus?
Teacher, this woman was caught in adultery in the very act. Now Moses and law commanded us as such to be stoned. But what did you say?
Okay. Stop right there. Okay, so y'all know what's going on? This woman right here was caught in the very act. My. Okay, and they bring her to Jesus, the scribes and the Pharisees. Veronica, tell me about the scribes and the Pharisees. What are the scribes and the Pharisees? Who are they?
They
were teachers of the law. So they knew the scripture.
Right?
Okay. And so they bring to Jesus this woman who was caught in the very act of adultery. And what do y'all say to her? Say it again, I like it. Go ahead, verse 4. What y'all say? Teacher.
Oh, teacher, this woman was caught in adultery in the very act. Now Moses and the law commanded us that such stone. But what do you say?
Okay, so now we're going to stay here in John 8, but the scripture that they're talking about is Deuteronomy 22. Veronica, go to Deuteronomy 22. And you're going to read 22 through 24. Praise God. Are you going to be a scribe and a Pharisee? You got to be in the story? Come on, you will be inscribed in fast. You go up there with them. You go up there with them. You cool. Okay, Veronica, Deuteronomy 22 through 24. Just read that.
If a man is found lying with a woman married to her husband, then both of them shall die. The man that lay with the woman and the woman, so you shall put away the evil from Israel. If a young woman who is a virgin is betrothed to a husband, and a man finds her in the city and lies with her, then you shall bring them both out to the gate of that city, and you shall stone them to death with stones. The young woman because she did not cry out in the city, and the man because he humbled his neighbor's wife, so you shall put away the evil from among you.
All right, so that's 20 through 22.
Well, that was actually 22 through 24.
No, 20 through 22.
Okay.
Oh, I'm sorry. Did I say, you said it right, 22 through 24. That was right, you did right, darling, thank you. Okay, so you guys see, this is the scripture that the scribes and the Pharisees were talking about. They were like, Jesus, this is what the law says, right? This is what the law says. Okay, so y'all wanna do it again? Brian, pull the mic towards him too this time. Okay, y'all ready? Go ahead, Zion. Y'all gonna say what verse 4 and verse 5 said. Yeah, say it again.
Yeah, what the outside
boy. Come on, let me hear you.
Teacher, this woman, that was very caught in adultery in the very act. Now Moses and the law commanded us that such should stone.
But
what did you say?
Okay, so this they said, testing him. Really testing. They weren't really testing the woman, they were testing Jesus. They were trying to trap Jesus, that they might have something of which to accuse him. But Jesus stooped down, come on Jesus,
And what did Jesus do? He wrote on the ground with his finger, as though he didn't hear. Now why Jesus acting like that? I love this part. So when they continued asking him, he said, you guys keep asking, what y'all asking? So what do you say about this woman caught in adultery? Go ahead, you just talk to her, right?
You gotta bring a coat to
you. I was very caught in adultery in the very act. Now Moses and the law commanded us that such be stoned. What do you say?
What do you say? And Jesus down there is like, he don't hear a thing. So when they continued asking, he raised himself up and said to them, give Jesus the mic. Go ahead, Jesus, what you say?
He who is without sin among you, let him throw a stone at her.
At her first, right?
At her first.
Okay, so I meant to bring y'all some stones, but y'all crazy, y'all probably wouldn't do it. Okay, so he's saying, what does that mean to you guys? He who is without sin, throw the stone at her first. Because according to the law, what were they supposed to do to her? What described the Pharisees said?
Stone her, kill her.
So one of the things I found out when I did some research was they couldn't, because first of all, they didn't bring the man.
Right,
they didn't bring the man. They have to have both people.
Both people. Right.
And it said she was caught in the very act. So they needed both of them.
Both of them.
Now, because the law actually says that there has to be two or three witnesses. So there has to be two or three witnesses in order for them to stone her. You made out good, girl. You made out real good. Okay, you have to have two or three witnesses. Okay, so then it says, verse 8, and again he stooped down on the ground. Then those who heard it, being convicted by their conscience, went out one by one. Y'all leaving now. Where y'all going?
Y'all leaving.
One by one, beginning with the oldest, even to the last. You get to lead two groups. And Jesus was left alone, and the woman standing in the midst. When Jesus had raised himself up and saw no one but the woman, he said to her,
woman, where are thou accusers of yours? Has no one condemned you?
All right, give a mic to the woman. And she said,
no one, Lord.
And Jesus said to her,
neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more.
Okay, so let's make sure, y'all stay right there. Let's make sure we understand what's going on here. Okay, oh, I love this. You know, the scripture says the letter of the law killeth. What does that mean? You can kill somebody with the scripture.
That's right.
What are you talking about? The letter of the law killeth. It's the spirit that gives it life.
Amen.
Right? So they tried to take the word and condemn her, right? Condemn her with the word, but it didn't qualify. Now, we're going to have a lot of fun. Y'all can sit down. We're going to have a lot of fun. You stay here, woman. Watch this. See, this is the way I was going to read the scripture, but I thought y'all might get upset, right? Wait a minute, hold on. Let me find the part. In verse 10, when Jesus had raised himself up and saw no one but the woman, he said to her, see, I'm going to say, ho, where are those accusers? Then I said, nah, that ain't what Jesus said.
Right.
But I thought, that's the way we would have said that today, right? We were like, right? But he's like, woman, where are your accusers? Glory to God. So watch this. Has no one condemned you? She said, no one, Lord. And Jesus said to her, what did he say?
Neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more.
Amen.
Good. Now this is where we give it a pick up. Thank you, sweetheart. You got to stay.
You might need to stay too. You said that. Okay, so we did the story. So many times people preach the story, but we knew that Holy Spirit wanted to take this story and do something else with the story. And I said, okay, so Jesus said, neither do I condemn you. What does that mean to you? What does that mean to you? Neither do I condemn you.
What?
no judgment. It forgives you.
What I mean to you?
To condemn means to almost like pronounce a judgment to hell, really. It's not just looking at somebody's right or wrong, but to condemn means to render a judgment.
Good Lord. Okay, so Jesus like, you know what? Neither do I condemn you, right? The people that were accusing you, they gone, because they couldn't qualify. Didn't nobody want to throw no stones after I said, he who has no sin, right? And so, Pastor Billy and I, we began to talk about this story, and we were like, okay, the power of love. You're like, what does this have to do with the power of love? And we were talking about it, it was like, well, the power of love didn't condemn him. Right? The power of love, but this is what Holy Spirit really began to talk to us about. The power of love forgives.
That's it. Amen.
Right? Let's just do that. Let's say that. The power of love forgives. Let's say it again. The power of love forgives. But watch this. I said, yeah, everybody likes that part. Right? Everybody likes that part. But nobody teaches the rest of the verse. He said, neither do I condemn you. Then what did he say next? Find it in the scripture. What did he say next?
You can go sin no more.
He said what?
Sin no more.
Then he said, go and sin no more. Let's say that. Go and sin no more. So we were like, the power of love forgives, but the power of love also sets free. Let's say that. The power of love forgives, but the power of love also sets you free. Glory to God. So it's not like Jesus said, I forgive you, now you just keep on hope. It's not like Jesus said, it's okay, you got away with it today. You good, now just keep on going and live your life. No. This is why a lot of people had a problem with the grace message.
Yes.
Right? Because they kept preaching the one side of it, right? Because grace says grace allows you to be free from judgment, free from all of that. But grace also requires holiness. Right? And so Jesus, that's real important. Like, yeah, Jesus is loving and Jesus is kind and Jesus forgives and Jesus, the power of love, right? But we began to talk about, we said, but Jesus also requires a holy life.
Yes.
He said, now I don't condemn you, but go and sin no more. We're like, okay, this now y'all ready? Because we started talking. Ooh, you ready for this?
I'm ready.
Ooh, go. You want to jump in? Go ahead.
What we got to understand is, and in the story now, he not only didn't condemn her, but the gentleman, he told them, the scribe, right, if you can cast the first stone, cast it. He also told them to go and don't judgment no one else. Now you're going to get your stuff together because you are of the same situation. So out of love, I'm telling you to go and do that no more. So everyone involved, he showed love to them all. Because he could have got them, every one of them has sinned. If they didn't, why didn't they cast the first stone? So, but the love of God, even in this situation, trying to condemn her or make her look bad, even test God, out of the whole situation, everybody walked away, not being condemned, and got another chance to get it right.
Good, thank God for another chance. Let's just say
and
that.
That's the grace.
Thank God for another chance.
See, right? That's the grace.
That's the power of love.
See,
the power of love gives you another chance to get it right.
And God's offer be extended to everybody that was involved.
Glory to God. Okay, so now here's what we want to teach. Because we love application. So this was a great story. But it's really important that you get something out of it. How does that apply to my life?
That's
right.
Right?
How does this apply to my life? So this is what we did. We said, okay, Jesus said, go and sin no more. How are you going to do that? Do that. Now what happened in that moment that now equipped her to go and sin no more? He didn't cast the devil out of her, did he? He didn't cast adultery out, did he? Did he anoint her with oil or anything? Did they pray? Did they fast? What happened? What happened in that moment? How could Jesus expect her in that moment now to go and
He did that too.
What did, come on, look at the verse. What did Jesus say to her? What did he say to her? Neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more. Okay, so if Jesus said it, what is it? What is it? What the words? What is it? It's the word.
It's the word.
Okay, so watch this. So, good glory to God. Watch this. The only thing Jesus gave her was what? The word. Please say the word is enough.
The word is enough.
Watch. So this is fun. Okay. Okay, woman that was caught in adultery, get up, darling.
Well, why are you saying that? Now listen, now the word says the word was God, the word was with God, and the word is God. So just the word is enough for her to not do it anymore.
But come on, let's
he
say it.
He gave her the word.
Let's say the word is enough.
The word is enough.
Okay, so he didn't order it off. He didn't cast no spirits out. He didn't do none of that. All he said to her was go and sin no more. Okay, here you go. Then what, you go ahead. You can wear the go and sin no more. Okay, so this is what you get to take with you now in your life. You go and sin no more. And he expects her to do that. And the only thing he left her with was what?
The word.
The word. The word, go and sin no more. Oh, wait a minute. Ooh, that's good, right? Go ahead. You got something. Give her a mic, baby.
I was just, my husband was talking about this morning. That we must know that we have a power and authority here on earth.
Yes.
And all is this, as pastor, they're saying that all we have to do is speak boldly out of our mouth and command our spirit to do what we wanted to do.
Yeah.
And we don't have to lay hands on nobody. We don't have to, like you said, anoint with oil. The word is enough.
Yeah.
The Bible tells us in St. John 15 that we came clean through the word of God. And that's all we got to take is the word of God to speak it with authority, command it. If you have an addiction, if you have a spirit, whatever it may be, all this woman that was calling the act of adultery, command her flesh to yield and align with the word of God. And that's all it takes.
That's good. Okay, so go to Proverbs 4. We're going to go to verse 20. Proverbs 4. Let's say again, the word is enough.
The word is enough.
That's all he gave her.
That's all he gave.
That's all he left her with was the word. Now, Proverbs 4.
Verse 20.
We're going to do verse 20.
Then we're going to go from 20 to 22.
20 to 22. Okay, while you guys are turning there. Now, the spirit of adultery is going to visit her again. Do y'all know that?
Yes.
Right.
The spirit of adultery, whatever you were caught in, see, whatever you are caught up in will come back to visit you. But the only thing she has to fight that thing is what?
Word.
The word. And the word. Go and sin no more. That's what she got. That's what she got to hold on to.
Yeah.
Here come. Come. I need a spirit. Come in. Come in. You be the spirit. Put that down. You're not a good spirit either. You're the spirit of adultery. You trying to catch her again. Levy, when he trying to catch you, what do you hold on to?
The word.
Go and sin no more. Now, that spirit's going to come. It's going to follow her because it's familiar with her.
Absolutely.
And so it knows her weakness. It knows everything about her when she starts feeling lonely.
That's right.
She know brother's phone number.
Alright.
And that spirit gonna try to talk to her. What she gotta hold on to? Go and sin no more. That's the word that God spoke to her. Let me tell you how it works in my life. When say like this morning, all these people sending me messages, not gonna be here today, not gonna be here today, not gonna be here today. And then I be like, yeah. See, if I get over into Donna, I be like, yeah, I'm just gonna shut this church down. Right? I'm just gonna shut. And then remember, God said, mark this day as the inception of household faith.
Do it other people.
I wrote it down. God said it to me. So when things don't, come on, when things don't look like it, I go back and read the word that God said to me. What I'm telling you, see, there's some things that God has said to you. And you gotta learn how to hold that word when all other things are trying to talk to you. You hold that word.
See, that,
all right,
that word from God is so powerful. You're coming in as nobody but you in the chair. You know the word that God gave you is powerful enough to come in and do what you're supposed to do, but you're being obedient and willing to what he told you to do. So you don't look at the numbers. And all them coming, what is that doing? The enemy trying to get you overwhelmed with what you're seeing, because we're seeing in a seeing realm.
Right.
But we need to operate in a word realm, meaning what God said is the only thing that stands. Let every man be a liar, but the word of God be the truth.
Yes.
So when he tell you that it is enough to sustain you in any situation. We have came in and it only been nobody in but my wife, me, and my son. And guess what happened?
We had church.
We had church like it was full, because the word told us to do that, and we're going to be obedient to that. And the rest is on God.
Now listen, she had a spoken word.
Mm-hmm.
God said to her, go and sin no more.
Absolutely.
So sometimes you have a spoken word, a prophetic word that God has spoken over your life, and you hold on to that word. But when you don't have that, you have the written word.
Okay.
And so you hold on to that word. You learn how. See, come on. Give me your Bible for a minute, Veronica. See, I want to teach you. This is equipment.
That's right.
Understand? See, this is equipment. See, I want to teach you how, when hell coming against you, what you do. What do you do? See, especially if it's a spirit of sickness, I go find a scripture on healing. Whatever's trying to come at you, the word has something for it. Glory be to God. Everything you need is in the word of God. So you go to the scripture and you start confessing it. You talk, you read it out loud. You sing it. You say it. You read it. You write it on a little postcard, 3x5 card, piece of paper. I don't care what it is. Write it down. Put it around the house. Every time you see it, you say it. Let's say that. Every time I see it, I say it. Let's do that again. Every time I see it.
And let me say this.
Can I like it? Can we do it one more time?
Every time I see it, I say. What you gotta understand is the enemy call you by the name of the sin. When he call you that, he may come. Remember, he don't come by himself, so he already got his posse. So when he leaving, knew he couldn't affect you, because the word, just the word, gonna run off. And he don't get an agreement, 1,000, 10,000. When you start getting agreement with other believers, they have to leave even more amount. So I'm saying that to say this. The enemy come with him and his posse. When he know he can't penetrate, he go back and he read what? He refills. He bring other folk. Now he come back with 30,000. And he can't penetrate. Now he got to go 60. So but the word of God will defeat any amount that come. So you need to be rehearsing the word. But now you got to know the word to rehearse it. Because the devil know the word. He was kicked out of heaven. He know the word as well as doing that, but he don't have to use it effectively, because he know that it cannot penetrate. Well, you know what you're talking about, and you say it with boldness, and you know you stand with authority and the power that God gave you. He can't defeat you, but he don't come by himself. So what's happening is he's bombarding your mind, and as he bombarding your mind, you got to know, if I can just get the word, just get it out, he must flee.
Glory to God. Let's say it again. The word is enough.
Enough.
Come on, let's do it again. The word is enough. Hey, and it doesn't matter. Pastor Billy talked about more spirits coming.
Right.
It doesn't matter how many come. It doesn't matter how many come. They're not enough to stand up against
the word.
There's absolutely nothing that can stand up against the word of God. You need to say that.
Help before the word defeat the word. He'll run out of help before he defeat the word.
All right, so let's go Proverbs 4 and 20, and we're reading 20 through 22. Y'all ready? Let's read it together. Let's go. My son, give attention to my words. Incline your ears to my sayings. Do not let them depart from your eyes. Keep them in the midst of your heart.
For they are life to those who find them,
and health to all their flesh. Now what's he talking about? He's talking about the word of God, right? What did he tell you to do with the word? What's the first verse 20? What did it say? Give attention to my word. What does that mean? What? Say it loud. Yeah. Pay attention. Give attention. Hold on to it. Mutter it. Put it in your mind. Keep rehearsing. Pastor Billy always says it to us. Rehearse the word.
And you don't need to read 4 or 5 chapters. You don't need to read 5 books. If you can read 1 chapter and get in your spirit, believe me, that's enough word to defeat any enemy. So you don't need to read 15 chapters if that's not in your spirit, man. Read one. Get it in your spirit, man, and where you can operate with that one. That is the word. It'll defeat any enemy.
Whoa.
But if we just read and just say, I read 5 chapters, but nothing in your spirit, man, you are witnessing. You're not being productive. He said, meditate on the word. That means if I meditate on one scripture, meditate on it and get that in my spirit, man, guess what? When I'm operating with my spirit, man, it's in there. It will come out.
Glory to God. I love what you said. The word is enough to defeat any enemy. Let's any say that. The word is enough to defeat any enemy.
Any enemy in any amount and any size.
Glory to God. All right, my son, give attention to my word. Whose responsibility is that?
Mine.
My responsibility. Come on, say it's my responsibility. All right. Then he says, incline your ear. Incline your ear to my sayings. What does that mean? Listen. Yeah. Intentional. Be intentional. Whose responsibility is that? Oh, glory to God. It's my responsibility. All right. So then he says, do not let them depart from your eyes. How we do that? We got to keep the word before us. You got to look at it.
That's right.
Keep them in the midst of your heart. Glory to God. Put it down on the inside of you. Glory to God.
And when you read it out loud. Let yourself hear it. Because it's entering your spirit, man. Let it hear it. It's one thing to read signs, but when you read it out loud, you are feeding your spirit, man, and hear it. It's one thing about hearing something, it just seems to seep it, it get deeper, it roots better. The roots go down deeper as it's hearing it. It's going deeper and deeper. So hear yourself reading it out loud. Read it out loud. Rehearse.
We go to Psalm 1. Now, this woman that was caught in adultery, she's giving attention to that word, go and sin no more. She's got to give attention to that. She's got to incline her ear to that. She's got to keep that in the midst of her eyes. Don't let it depart from her eyes. She got to hold on to the word that God said to her, go and sin no more. Go and sin no more. That's what Jesus said to me. That's what Jesus said to me. Go and sin no more. I will go and sin. Now you make it personal.
Yes.
Now it's not just Jesus said it to me. Now it's I will go and sin no more. Now that spirit comes again.
Yep.
Here comes that spirit. What you say to the spirit? I will go and sin no more. Glory be to God. And guess what? And the spirit don't care if she just said that. No. He gonna stand up, and she just bluffing. Watch, if I stay, let's see what'll happen if I stay. Mm-hmm. Let's see what happens if I stay. Yeah, and he stay, and what do you do? I will go and sin no more.
Keep telling. Keep saying.
Glory be to God. And you gotta stand, right? When you haven't done all to stand, what do you do? Stand!
Holy Spirit said, when you're standing, you done defeated the enemy, whether he's standing there or not. He's defeated. He can stand there if you're saying a word, you don't even see him.
Hey, Zion, go right
the
there.
Word shields, the word shields that enemy from you. When you're saying the word, the enemy can stand right there. If you're saying a word enough, you won't even see the enemy.
Say that again, Jesus.
The word will shield you from the enemy. If you're saying the word enough, the enemy could be standing right there. You won't even see him.
Whoa,
really, because listen now, he's trying to do what intimidates you. But he could stand there. The word will shield you with what you're saying. The enemy can't even penetrate. It's already defeated.
Because he understands the powers in the word. Come on. He understands the powers in the word. What he's hoping is that you don't understand.
Absolutely.
See, I need you to get that. He understands the powers in the word. He's hoping that you don't know it.
That's right.
He's hoping he can back you up off of it.
Right.
See, how many of you ever been there? Like all of a sudden, you don't get stopped. Because you get over your emotions and here we go. What you meditate on is what you're able to do.
Absolutely.
So when you start meditating on the word, you can walk out that word that you meditate on. If you start meditating on the mess, then you'll start walking out that mess.
Right.
Right? Because what you magnify is your God.
Absolutely.
Oh, yeah. What you magnify is your God. How am I magnifying it? I start saying it out of my mouth. Yes. Whatever you start talking about, then all of a sudden you worship. Come on. What you talk about, you worship.
You worship.
Yes.
And the word, listen to me, the word of God is accurate, excellent, and is done with boldness.
Yeah.
When you're doing that, it's nothing the enemy can do to uncheck that. The only way he can uncheck that is you and I give our accuracy, boldness, and what excellence of the word to him. We relinquish our power to him. Now he reverses it on us. So the power we relinquish, he uses it against you and I.
Oh, come on. You need to say that right there, right? The only way I lose is if I relinquish my rights.
My rights to.
Come on. The only way I lose is if I relinquish my rights. Do you understand that? You are a winner.
That's automatic.
You are a winner. You are victorious.
This.
You are more than a conqueror. You are exactly what the word of God says you are. And the only way the enemy can defeat you is if you relinquish your rights.
That's right.
Yes, I was going to say too that, you know, it talks about drawing nigh to God, resisting the devil, and that's what, you know, what you do when every time it presents itself,
yeah,
you're resisting with the word, and the word promises that he will flee.
But
it also means too that, you know, although you're saying it with your mouth, you have to be careful with your thought life too,
yeah,
that what you're thinking is lining up with what you're saying.
Yeah.
Because if you're saying one thing, but in your heart and in your mind, you're really still kind of drawn to him. You know, the enemy is attracted to us spiritually through the thoughts that we think.
Yeah.
And so you got to make sure that the heart and the mind is lining up with what you are speaking, because he knows whether you're speaking truth or not.
Yeah.
And so you've got to get to that place where we understand that even if your heart isn't quite there, God, help my heart. Help my
heart
to line up with what my words are saying. Help me to resist wholeheartedly and with a pure heart and with a pure mind.
Yeah, right. I'm glad you did that second part, because it's real important. You go like, well, how do I do that when my mind starts tripping, right? My mind's not. So this is what I say it until I believe it.
That's right.
Right? Faith comes by hearing and hearing.
Yes.
So the more I hear him say it, the more I believe it. Glory to God.
That's
I just keep saying, see, I renew my mind with the word.
That's right.
I take authority over my mind. I tell my mind what it's going to say, right? So I said, I did that all day yesterday. I watched Nancy, I love her. I watched Nancy Faith preach to me, preach to me, preach to me. What am I doing? I'm renewing my mind.
That's right.
I'm renewing my mind. Transform it, change the way I'm thinking,
right.
Change the way I'm thinking, change, because as a man thinking in his heart, so is he.
Now, let's share this with you. In her mind,
yeah,
when she says she's renewing her mind now, don't go to this mind. Her spirit man is being renewed. We need to understand as believers, our spirit man must take control. When our spirit man take control, what we hear going to our spirit man, which means once it's in my spirit man, faith is not in your head. So when I'm releasing my faith and what I'm believing, it has to be out of my spirit, man, which means I can have doubt. I can have doubt in this head, but faith in my heart, and it will come to pass. Why? Because the power is in where my faith lies. The power. So once again, as long as I can remove it from here into my spirit, man, I can have doubt right here. But my spirit, man, is so strong, it's going to overtake this thought, because faith is not here, and it will come to pass. But you got to rehearse it enough to where it's in your spirit, man. No matter what this say, you say, you know what? No. I don't operate out of this. My faith lies where my spirit man dwells. This is where it comes from. But once again, I can have doubt here. Dad Hagin done said it and done proved it. I can have doubt here and faith right here, and it will come to pass. But you got to rehearse it enough to where your spirit man knows I'm in control, not this one.
Yeah. But what happens is this man overtakes
you.
As a man thinketh in
his heart.
Wait, watch it. As a man thinketh in his heart. Not as a man thinketh in his head. Oh, I love the word. As a man thinketh where?
In
his heart, so is he. In his heart, so is he. In his heart. That's my spirit, man.
That's
not this bubble. In my spirit. As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. And so when you put the word down, it goes down in your heart.
Absolutely.
And my spirit, man, is renewed day by
Amen.
Watch it. Woo. I gotta take what's in my spirit and renew my mind. How do I renew my mind? I take the word and I start hearing the word and that starts changing my mind. Come on, tell somebody you can change your mind.
Yes, you can.
Glory be to God. My mind is submissive to the word of God. That's what I tell my mind.
Yes.
So, okay, Psalm 1. We're going to read it all together. We're going to read verse 1 and 2. Y'all ready?
Yes.
All right, let's go.
Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stand in the path of the sinners, nor sit in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night.
Now, I love this. Why? Because you can't stay free from adultery if you're hanging out with adulterers.
That's right.
Yes. Yes. What the first verse say?
Blessed is the man who walk not in the counsel of the ungodly.
I ain't walking in the counsel of the
ungodly.
That means you gotta leave Pookie in there.
Yes.
If you're trying to stop something, you can't hang with people who's still doing it. Now, you can love the people,
right.
But you can't hang with the people. Tell somebody you can love the people, but you can't hang with the people.
Love them from long distance. Love them from long distance so that you can continue to do what you're trying to do. You're trying to continue to stay delivered from it.
All right, so you can't walk in their counsel. And you know the ungodly love the counsel.
Oh, my. Oh, my.
That love to tell you how to
do it.
All right, now watch this. Nor stand in the path of sinners. Nor sit in the seat of the scornful. And just telling you, you can't hang with those that do the thing you're trying to get free from. Oh my goodness.
Even if you think you're strong enough, don't hang with it.
That's
even if you're telling yourself you're strong enough, still don't hang with it. Because you can be strong one moment and weak another. If they catch you at your weakest point, guess what you're doing? Huh? You know, it's okay. So even if you feel you're strong enough, don't hang with that.
That's good, Pastor.
That way you can stay strong.
Glory to God.
That's right.
Hey, what happened if you stop going to the gym? See, I was going. Right, I was going. Let me tell you, I was going to work, I'm going to water aerobics 3 days a week. Monday, Wednesday, Friday, I'm in the pool. Right? I missed 2 weeks. I went back Monday and got them little weights in that water. And Monday night, I had to go to bed. I'm telling you the truth. It was like I was starting all over again. What happened? I had a lapse.
Yep.
All right.
Listen in the spirit. Don't allow a lapse. Go tell somebody. Don't allow a lapse. No, you gotta, every day you gotta get in the Word.
Yes.
Every day. See, it's like going to the gym. Every single day, I'm gonna build my faith muscle.
That's right.
Every day I'm working out in the Spirit. Ooh, that's good. Tell that. Every day I'm working out in the Spirit. Come on, let's say it again.
Every day I'm working out in the Spirit.
Ooh, that's good. Ooh, ooh, glory to God. Okay, so verse 2. But his delight was said to me instead of.
That's right.
Instead of standing in the path of sinners, instead of sitting in the seat of the scornful, instead of walking in the counsel of the ungodly, what is he doing? His delight. Wait a minute, delight. His delight. What's that? Man, he's enjoying.
He's doing good.
Man, his delight is in the law of the Lord. See, right now, I gotta read the scripture. That's not delight, is it? No, but when you realize that the word is enough, how powerful the word of God is, darling, it'll become your delight. Glory to God. The word is my delight. Come on, say it.
The word is my delight. But make that intentional to get the word in front of you, whatever you do every day. If you get the word in front of you and you fall asleep, leave it open. When you wake up, just read it again. Always get the word in you. Do not let no one tell you you can't do it. If you got to open your Bible as you sleep, put it on your chest. When you wake up, read it. Make sure you get some word in you, because you feed your natural man 3 times a day. So even if you're praying and you nod up and you wake up and you're on your knees, continue praying. Get it in. It don't matter what.
Glory to God. Okay, so his delight is in the law, and in the law, which is the word, what does he do?
He meditates.
He does what?
Meditates.
What does that mean? Come on. What does it mean? You open it up in your mind.
Rolling it over. Rehearse it.
What Pastor Billy said. Rehearse that word. Over and over in my mind. A woman caught in adultery, what you gonna say? rehearsing. I'm rehearsing what God said to me. I'm rehearsing what God said to me. I'm rehearsing what the Word said. I rehearse the Word. Come on. I rehearse the Word. Well, glory to God. What happens to you when you start rehearsing the Word? It becomes a part of you. Guess what? Before you know it, you don't have to go find the Bible to find it. It's already inside of you.
Inside of you.
So much, it's speaking to me when I ain't speaking to you. Glory to God.
It's rehearsing for you. It started rehearsing for you. It started telling you what you rehearsed to say. Remember you said this?
Yes.
So the Word started rehearsing for you.
Yes.
In you. It started saying it back to you. So it's always rehearsed. Do you know statistics say you have between 60,000 to 80,000 thoughts a day? How many do we intentionally take and rehearse that word? When you get it in you, she just told you the word will start coming out of you and you're not even trying to say it.
Well, I say like this, Veronica, you got a group. Y'all rehearse. Why do y'all rehearse? So that you can learn.
Yeah,
grow, flow, and minister out of what we call it.
So, wait a minute. So you rehearse. So that when it's time for the ministry moment, you can minister out of what you already learned.
Amen.
Wait a minute. You rehearse so that when that moment comes, that you can minister out of what you already learned. That's good, right? Why do we rehearse? So when that moment comes, I can minister out of what I already learned, what I rehearsed. Oh, man. Practice makes permanent.
That's right.
Come on, practice makes permanent. What I practice in that moment of tribulation, in that moment of testing, in that moment of trial, I will do what I have
practiced. Absolutely.
Oh, that's good. So let's ask this. What have you been practicing? Come on. What have you been rehearsing?
Yeah.
What have you been practicing?
And the practice in this, practice makes perfect. Practice also makes you sharp. Listen to this. Sharp. The word is a double-edged sword.
Yes,
it cuts going in and coming out. So as you practice that, the word is so sharp, it do surgery going in and out. But if you're not practicing it, how will you be sharp with it?
All right. Go ahead, darling. She got something.
And the Spirit says, the more you practice something, the more you rehearse something, that taste that you once had for something will be gone. That taste, when you can begin to practice and rehearse the Word of God, that taste for that thing you once had will be gone.
Glory! Glory! Just wait a minute. Come on. Y'all remember that commercial? Shout it out. Shout it out. Y'all remember that? It was this spot remover.
Yes.
You put
And listen, the word it out will work for you no matter how what size you are, no matter how much time you've been a believer, no matter how old you are, word it out will work for anybody. Anybody. You just have to put the word it out on the situation and it'll work for anybody. God knows the smallest baby in it is still a person. It's still a child of God. She can operate the same way someone is if they're 7 years old or 5 feet tall. The word it out will work for anybody that will use it.
Hey, put the word on it. Go and tell somebody.
Put the word on it.
Put the word on it. Somebody catch Abby up. Tell the word it out. Put the word on it, Abby. Put the word on it, darling.
Yeah.
Any situation, anything that's trying to hold you captive, anything that's trying to bother you, what you do?
Put the word on it.
Amen.
Glory be to God. And Veronica already read the scripture to us. Resist the devil. The word on it. And what is that? And he will flee. Glory be to God. Listen, quote that again. This time, you do what the devil does. You
flee.
Go ahead, put the word on it.
Amen.
Glory be to God. Woo. Glory to God. The word will make the devil flee.
flee.
Yes, you will. The word will make the devil flee. Every time.
The word will make the devil flee. Come on.
The word will make the devil flee.
Ooh, glory to God. Ooh, glory. All right, go to Joshua chapter 1. Ooh, glory. Ooh, the word will make the devil flee. Ooh, all the Jesus. Come on,
what the quickness.
You know how the word tells you, Veronica, that there's a great cloud of witnesses, and that they're looking over on us. I just know something in my spirit. There's also a great cloud of witnesses of demons peeking over us. And when we just said that the word will make the devil run, they left. Glory be to God. Oh man, let me tell y'all something. As long as we keep having cute church and standing and watching, look at them having church. Devils and demons, look at them having church. But the moment that we start putting the word inside of you where you know what to do with the word, they say, man, we got to back up off of this place.
Absolutely.
They are equipping these people. They ain't just talking stuff. Right. They're not just having church. They are equipping them with the word. What are we going to do with the household of faith people? We can't do nothing with the people that go to household of faith because they are equipped with the word. What are we going to do with them people over at household of faith? They happen to have a board meeting, Brian, about the people that go to household of faith. They said they're training them people. They're teaching them the word. They're telling them to walk in authority. They're not just having church. They're going into the presence.
And now, hey, the Bible won't have us ignorant, right? So the Bible told us in Job, even when he released his prayer, the angel was in route to him, they stopped and had to fight the prince of Persia.
But you're talking about Daniel.
And Daniel, even in that fight, after they did the fight, the prince of Persia, they released him when he prayed on the way to rescue you. It took them 20-some days because they had to do the battle. But think about this. So when you do it, already know the battle is already yours. Just be patient. Rest in the patience so that the victory can get to your where you can see the manifestation. Once you release it, the battle done already taking place and you already won. Whether it take 1 day, 2 days, 5 minutes, it don't matter. The victory is yours. So that's why you're rehearsing the word until the victory is where you can now see it. It's already taking place. So rehearsing the word keep me in the presence of the what? The resting in that position to where it's where I can now manifest it. But the battle was already taken care of as soon as he prayed and then they released him. He had to fight whatever needed to take. Because listen to me, the enemies was trying to do what? Keep him from coming into their domain. But he couldn't stop them. He just needed to take care of this little, look, this, get this out of my way so that I can do what I was called to do. I must get to the believer because God already released me and told me, this is what you need to do.
They
do whatever it takes. They spoke the word.
Angels
must come.
They hearken to the voice of the word.
And them enemies couldn't stop them.
Glory, Prince of Persia had to let it go.
But had to let it go.
All right, go to Joshua 1:8. And this is what, when Pastor Billy was speaking, this is what I heard in my spirit. Rehearsal will put you at rest.
Oh, glory to God.
Veronica, what y'all rehearse, they become more confident in.
Yes.
Wait, what you rehearse, you become more confident in. Come on, what you rehearse, you become more confident in. Glory to God, I'm better at it now. Glory to God. I'm fully equipped. Glory to God. Because I've been rehearsing. What you rehearse, you are more confident in, right? Glory be to God.
You walk so much now, you miss a step. Can you catch up a step where you don't fall? You can trip and catch a step the way you catch yourself before falling, right? You don't rehearse that enough. If you do that with the word and the enemy come, you say, whoa, 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 no, no, you won't trip me up. I recognize you.
Yeah. And I know what to do.
And I know what to do.
All right. Joshua 1:8. Everybody there?
Yes.
Let's read it together. Ready? Let's go.
This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night. That you may...
Stop right there. What's the book of the law? Well, they were talking about this particular book. But we know the word of God.
Right.
The word of God shall not depart from my mouth. Let's say that.
The word of God shall not depart from my mouth.
Now, the enemy wants to silence you.
Oh, yes.
Okay. He wants to get you so upset till you are silent.
Yeah.
Y'all hear that?
Yeah.
He wants to put you in silence. He wants to stop you you from talking the word. So he's going to do everything in his power to get you to stop speaking the word. What? He wants you to say what you see.
Yeah.
He wants you to say how you feel. He wants you to say all the foolish stuff that don't line up with the word. But don't let the word depart from your mouth. That's what the word says. I won't let the word depart from my mouth. Talk to yourself.
I won't let the word depart from my mouth.
Glory be to God. Okay, so now where are we at?
We're at the second part.
Okay, this book of the law, let's read again.
This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth.
But you shall meditate in it day and night. Let's say that about yourself.
I will meditate in the word day and night.
Let's do it again.
I will meditate in the word day and night.
This is what I believe. I believe believers don't believe that the word is the word.
That's right. It's the truth.
If you really believe how powerful that word is, you wouldn't leave it on the table till Wednesday and Sunday. When you really understand how vitally important this is to your life, right? See, when you really understand how powerful this is, and that this is the only thing that'll cause the enemy to back up off of you, then all of a sudden it becomes precious.
Yes, it do.
It's my life.
It's the lifeline.
It's your lifeline.
As a believer, this is your lifeline.
This is it right here. This is my life.
This is it.
Glory to God. See, we're going to renew our minds about the word.
Yes.
How valuable the word is. How precious the word is. How important the word is to your life. The word is the only thing that can bring victory to you.
And to you.
All right. Okay, let's start again. Ready? Let's read. This book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night. Now, why? That you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. Let's stop there. Why are we reading it?
So you can do all things that's written in it. What's in it?
So we can rehearse what we just read.
Amen.
What I read, I rehearse. Come on.
What I read, I rehearse.
Let's do it again.
What I read, I rehearse.
What I mean? That means I read and I walk it out. I believe it's true.
Yes.
I believe it's true. So I act on it. I read it, I rehearse it. Man, this is good stuff, man.
Good stuff.
Josh, you should be writing a rap right now. I read it, I rehearse it. Glory to God. All right, this book of the law should not depart from my mouth, but I should meditate in it day and night, that I may observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then.
Yes.
Wait a minute. For then. What does that mean?
If I do it.
It means I got to do all the stuff before it.
And here come the reward.
Okay, so what things I got to do? Come on, what I got to do?
I meditate in the word. Not depart from my mouth.
And then keep it in my mouth. Meditate in it, I got to say it.
That's right.
I got to meditate in the word, and I got to say the word. I got to meditate in the word, and I got to say the word. What's the next one? Then I got to do the word. I got to meditate in the word, I got to say the word, I got to do the word. I got to meditate in the word, I got to say the word, I got to do the word. One more time. I got to meditate in the word,
I got to say the word, then I got to do the word.
Then say, then.
Then.
What's going to happen then?
You will make your way prosperous.
Wait a minute, you'll do what?
You will make your way prosperous.
That's good.
So you make your way prosperous, God.
You will do what?
You will make your way prosperous. Make. The emphasis on the make.
You will do what?
You will make your way prosperous.
My way don't have a choice but to be prosperous.
If it don't want to be, must be prosperous.
My way, I make my way prosperous. How you do that? Glory to God. How you do that? I meditate in the word, I say the word, I do the word. When I do that, I make my way prosperous.
And then what? You will have good success. Now listen to me. Bad success is not bad. Because you're successful. But it said good success. Bad success can mean I'm on a lower level but successful. I'm on a hot, but when good success, listen to me, I don't believe it's a limit to it. I will have, and the word said it, I know it's no limit to it. I'll have good success, so anything I touch could be successful as long as I'm doing this.
Isn't that good? All right, last scripture, Hebrews 4:12. And I believe we're close there. Hebrews 4:12. Ooh, glory, we learned a lot, didn't we?
Amen.
What we rehearsed, ooh, glory. We walked that thing out.
Walk it out.
Glory to God. I meditate in the word, I say the word, I do the word, I make my way prosperous, I have good success. That's the plan right
there. That's the plan.
Hey, listen, that's the plan.
That's the formula.
That's the plan. I meditate in the word, I say the word, I do the word, I make my way prosperous, I have good success. That's the plan right there.
Right there.
Meeting the term, that's the plan. Glory to God. All right, Hebrews 4:12. Ooh, glory. Because we need to know what the word is. How powerful the word of God is.
Yes.
Ooh, glory to God. Thank you, Holy Ghost, for teaching us and talking to us. Hebrews 4:12. Y'all ready?
Yes.
Let's go.
For the word of God is living and powerful and sharper than two two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of our soul and spirit, and of joints and marrow, and of the discerner of the thoughts and intent of the heart.
Ooh, glory to God. Then the word is bad, ain't it?
Ooh, glory.
It's quick and powerful. It's
sharp.
Quick. That word quick doesn't mean fast, it means alive.
Alive.
It's alive. The word is alive.
Yes.
It's living and powerful. It's alive. Glory be to God. That it's not dead. It's alive. The word is alive. So, Brian, if I'm meditating in the alive word and I'm saying the alive word and then I'm doing the alive word, that's how it makes my way prosperous, because it's alive.
It's alive.
When I meditate and I do it and I say it, it's alive. It goes to work for me.
Right.
Come on. The word goes to work for me.
So you know when you're doing something and you're alive, dead don't even come around. So if you do, when you're doing something and it's alive, dead don't even come around. So if you're rehearsing the word that way and every time you rehearse it's alive, dead cannot even come around live.
Yes. Holy God. Wow. Ooh, that's good. Dead can't come. Anything dead can't come,
come around
near me.
Come around.
Anything dead don't can't come around. Hallelujah. Thank you.
It already did it.
Hallelujah.
We just need to receive it.
Jesus is the word. So the word is the resurrection and the life. Right? Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. But Jesus is the word.
He's the word.
So the word is the resurrection and the life. So when I send the word to anything dead,
God is going to lie. I don't care if it died this morning, you put the word on it, got to come back alive. If it died 10 years ago, you put the word on it, guess what? Breath is in it right then.
Glory to God.
Because it's the word.
Because it's the word. We spoke again last week. Lazarus, come in dead. They said, but Lord, he stinking.
Yeah.
He been dead 4 days. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. Wait a minute. What went in the tomb and got Lazarus?
The word.
What went and got Lazarus?
The word.
Jesus didn't physically go in and kill.
No, he sent the word.
The word went in.
He sent the word.
The word went in. The word went in. The word went in.
Hallelujah.
Y'all know who's wrong with it?
Hallelujah.
The word went in the tomb.
In the tomb.
He didn't even have to go. He sent the word.
So listen, the word could go anywhere it must go, through mountains, around mountains, over mountains. And listen, anywhere it must go, the word can get there.
Remember in the scripture, he said, Master, you don't have to go, just send your word.
That's what he said.
Send the word.
That's what don't just send it. We've done that. We done sent the word to houses that said someone's sick. My wife and I prayed and said, we done sent the word to so-and-so house. Y'all are ill. Just send the word.
Glory to God. Okay, so what we get out of this today, we realize that the word is powerful.
Yes.
It's alive. It's sharper than any two-edged sword. The word is the resurrection and the life. And all I got to do is meditate in it, say it, and do it. And it makes my way prosperous. And I have good success. Glory to God. And if there's any situation, we can word it out. We can word it out.
Put the word on.
Put the word on.
Put the word on.
Come on, high five. Somebody
put the word on. Just put the word on. Just put the word on.
You put the word on.
Put the word on and watch what happens to it.
Put the word on.
Put the word on it and watch what
happens.
Put the word on it and then watch what happens.
Who tells somebody that?
Put the word on it and watch what happens.
Who that is? Oh my, my, my. Oh, glory. All right, darling. Those of you that are watching,
yes.
Whatever situation you in, whatever's going on in your life, put the word on it and watch what happens. Put the word on it and watch what happens.
Yes.
Oh God, Father, we thank you for your word.
Thank you for the word.
Forgive us for just acting like the word didn't mean anything. Forgive us, God, every time we threw our Bible on the floor and kicked it under the table in the bed. Forgive us, God, for forgetting what you paid for us to have that word right here. Forgive us, God. Holy Spirit, breathe that word. Holy Spirit, spoke that word. We thank you that you left us a will. Thank you, God. You left us the word of God. Hallelujah. And then you told us what we can do with the word. Glory to God. We thank you right now. So I'm telling you that you can take the word and you can change your situation. I don't care what it looks like. The word can work it out. Glory to God.
Yes.
Oh, glory. You want to lead them in salvation.
And if we would, listen, everyone, even in the house that's present with us, in Facebook Live, all those, we need you to know that we need to, just listen, just say this, Lord, forgive me for my sins.
And just
come into my heart.
Yes.
Come into my heart.
Yes.
And listen, we confess with our mouth that Jesus died and he rose again. Just for you.
Yeah.
If you do that and just make Lord Jesus of your life, you are saved. And then you can start operating in the benefits which we are operating right now. Everything that we taught, everything that we told you is yours today. It's yours. Get into a Bible teaching church and just get this word and rehearse. Rehearse it till it's in your spirit man to where it just starts to flow out of you. And you can operate and receive this today. If you confess that with your mouth and believe it in your heart, you are saved. Listen to me. Operate in the benefits right now. So we just tell you, even on Facebook Live in this house, if you said that now, you are saved. You need to start operating, utilizing your benefits. You got an insurance policy, you can use the benefits today. So now that you receive that policy, put it into operation for you today. Rehearse the word. But listen, word it out. Any situation you're in right now, you have the power and the authority to word it out. Exercise your faith.
Amen.
Thank you, God.
Josh, glory to God.
Yeah.
Oh, that's good. Thank you, God.
Thank you, Lord.